Hello everyone, welcome to the webinar Cathodoluminescence Imaging for Plasmonics. I'm here today with my colleague Toon Coenen, who is our product manager at Delmic, and he's going to be talking about the possibilities of cathodoluminescence for studying plasmonic structures. Before we begin, I would like to mention that on the right side of the screen you can see the questions tab. So feel free to ask any questions that you have during the presentation, and Toon is going to answer them within and at the end of the presentation. Also, you can see the tab called polls. These are some of the questions that we have for you. So please let us know what you think about these things, and we really appreciate your feedback. I'm not now going to give the word to Toon.
All right, thank you, Vera. Good morning, everyone, or good afternoon, depending on where you are from. And so indeed, I will discuss today how cathodoluminescence imaging can be applied to the field of plasmonics. And in particular, I will briefly introduce surface plasmons, what they are. Then I will discuss in a little bit more detail how you can actually excite plasmons with electrons. And then I will move on to explain a little bit about how we detect plasmons within our system. And then I will have several examples showing how you can image plasmons at the nanoscale. And I will end with an outlook. So surface plasmons are hybrid electromagnetic waves where light couples to the conduction electrons in a metal. And these surface plasmons, they are a solution to Maxwell's equations, and they are what is called a transverse magnetic wave or excitation, where the electric field is oriented out of plane and the magnetic field is mostly pointing in plane. And so if such a wave can propagate across the interface, that is called a surface plasmon polariton, SPP. And if you would truncate such a interface to a small size, for example, nanoparticle, then this plasmon wave can become resonant and you can create what is called a localized surface plasmon, which is really a resonant phenomenon. Now, plasmons have gained a lot of interest because they have the ability to strongly confine light to volumes that are much smaller than the wavelength. And so the main motivation for doing plasmonics is just that, for confining light to very small volumes and to do things that you cannot do with other geometries or free space light. And so there are various types of plasmonic materials out there that have good plasmonic properties, each with their own advantages and disadvantages. They also operate in different wavelength regimes. And so aluminium, for example, is good for ultraviolet plasmonics, whereas gold is used a lot for visible and near-infrared plasmonics. And gold is used a lot also because it's because of its stability and because of its convenience in nanofabrication. And so if you go further into the infrared, there are also other compound materials available that also show plasmonic properties. But today we'll mostly consider metals. So looking at the applications, all of these applications of plasmonics, they revolve around the ability of plasmons to confine light to such small volumes. And so in particular, plasmonic systems have the ability to strongly enhance and direct emission from single emitters, for example, single photon sources, a molecule, quantum dots. And on top of that, because the structures have the ability to confine light to such small volumes, you can also create very high electric field amplitudes. And that is great for enhancing nonlinear effects, such as Raman scattering, for example. And so plasmonic structures are very efficient in enhancing Raman signals, but also other processes like second harmonic generation, four-wave mixing, etc. All of those things can be enhanced with plasmonic systems. And so for the same reason, they are also interested in for sensing. And so because you can confine light to small volumes, you can be sensitive to very small volumes of material. And there are ideas to employ that type of scheme in a large parallel sensing array, as is sort of shown here schematically. And the ultimate dream is to build a lab on a chip where you can test, for example, a droplet of blood in parallel for a lot of different pathogens, just to give an example. Because these particles, they confine light to very small volumes, they sometimes also generate a lot of local heat. And that also has several applications, one of which is the destruction of tumor cells, where the heat is used to overheat tumor cells and to kill them. And similarly, it has also been shown that you can perform low threshold steam generation. And maybe one of the most important technological applications is that this heat can also be used to locally flip magnetic moments in magnetic bubble memory, which is still one of the most important technologies for hard disks nowadays. And that will makes the hard disks faster and more energy efficient. So let's now move to cathodoluminescence imaging. And so what is it? You excite your material with an electron beam. And during that process, a lot of signals are generated simultaneously. But one of those signals is light. And that is what you measure in cathodoluminescence. And the main motivation for doing cathodoluminescence, in particular in the field of plasmonics, is that you, because you're using an electron beam with a small beam waste, you can study materials at length scales that are much smaller than the diffraction limit of light. So you can really study the optical properties of these materials at the nanoscale. So let's look in a little bit more detail at how the excitation of plasmons works in cathodoluminescence. And so for that, it is useful to look at the electric field that is associated with an electron. And so if you are an observer and an electron would zip by and you would look at the electric field of that, you would see a single field oscillation going first to negative values, then positive values for the parallel field component, and just a single rise and fall of the perpendicular field component. And this happens very fast, especially for electrons that you have in an electron microscope. They move very quickly. And so if you would take the Fourier transform of this electric field, then you would see that that corresponds to a very broad frequency range. And that means that especially at optical frequencies, the electron beam acts as a wide source of electric field. And so you can consider the electron beam to be a super continuum source of electric field. And this electric field, it sticks to the electron when it is propagating. That is called evanescent. And so the field, it sticks out away from the electron a little bit, on the order of 10 to 20 nanometers or so, or a little bit less even. But it doesn't not propagate away from the electron. It's not coupled to radiation. But if you perturb the electron in some way, for example, by letting it pass through an interface where the dielectric environment changes, then the electron couples to, or it polarizes the electrons in the material, and that polarization charge can directly radiate, which is known as transition radiation. But it can also couple to other electromagnetic modes that are available, one of which is plasmons or surface plasmons that can propagate, for example, across the interface, couple out through corrugations like a grating, and then can be detected by cathodoluminescence. So there are a couple of important things that I would like to mention as well. And so because the electron beam is very confined, it has a broad momentum distribution. And that means that you can directly couple to these propagating plasmon modes. And that is in fact forbidden for a light. And so if you would come in with a light beam on a flat gold crystal, you would not be able to excite surface plasmons directly. You need some source of extra momentum, like a grating. For electrons, this is not necessary. Another thing is that the probability that the electron couples to these modes is directly proportional to the local density of optical states, which is a key quantity in optics that determines how light couples to matter and vice versa. And so, in other words, the electron beam, it is a very powerful probe for measuring local density of states effects and optical modes at the nanoscale. So just some historical remark. And so measuring plasmons with electrons has been done for a long time. And in fact, you could argue that the field of plasmonics was actually started by in the field of electron beam interactions with materials or electron microscopes with thin metal foils. And here are some examples from the 40s and 50s where scientists were doing the first interpretations and experiments on metallic thin films and trying to understand where some of the losses that they were seeing in the electron energy were coming from. And one of those sources was plasmons. And so it really dates back to this time. But with the current advances in equipment and in the microscopes and also in the plasmonic materials themselves, a lot more is possible nowadays. So let's see, are there any questions so far? No. So our system is a plug-in system for a conventional SEM. And this our system can be plugged into many SEM systems, different brands, different types. And it consists of two parts. One part is the collection system, which is inside of the electron microscope. And this consists of a parabolic mirror, which you see here. And this parabolic mirror has a small hole in it through which the electron beam can access a sample. And it is connected to this micropositioning system, which can be used to properly align the mirror with respect to your sample, such that the light collection efficiency is maximized. And the other thing is that this positioning system can also be used to retract the mirror away from the pole piece region. And this allows you to use the microscope in a normal way where the mirror is not obstructing any signals. It can be useful in some cases if your electron microscope is also used for other things. So after the light is collected, it goes on into the detector here. And so in the front, there's optics that is used to focus the emitted cathodoluminescence towards the spectrometer here, which is in the back. And there in the spectrometer, the signal is measured by different detectors. So in the SPARC system, the CL system, we have different imaging modes available to analyze the signal. And I will show some examples of these later on. And so the most common one that we use is spectroscopy, where you measure the wavelength dependence of the cathodoluminescent signal. Can be used to identify resonances, for example, in a plasmonic nanoparticle. You can also look at the angular profile, where you measure the intensity as function of angle. And that is highly useful in structures that are designed to be directional, like antennas or metasurfaces. You can also analyze the polarization dependence. That can, for example, be very useful in the case of chiral structures that emit elliptical or circularly polarized light. And finally, we also use what is called energy momentum imaging, which is essentially a combination between spectroscopy and angle-resolved imaging to measure dispersion and directionality as function of energy in more detail. If you are interested in learning more about this technique, I refer you to one of the previous webinars that we have given about this topic. There's a detailed webinar on that, actually, if you are interested. So now I will cover some examples of how the technique can be used in the context of plasmonics. And the first example I have is a metallic nanorod, a gold nanorod, 185 nanometers long. And it's about 30 nanometers thick. And what you can do is that you can scan the electron beam across this particle point by point. And for every point, you collect a spectrum. A full spectrum. Remember that the electron beam is a white light source, so you can collect a wide range of energies determined by the spectrometer that you're using. And if you would average over the all the data points that you have, then you would see the following spectrum. And in that spectrum, you see two peaks. And those peaks correspond to plasmonic resonances that you have in this particle. And so the fact that you can measure that on a single particle is very nice. That is sometimes quite difficult with optical microscopy, especially if the particles become smaller. And so the fact that you can measure that on a single particle is already appealing. And it means that you don't have to do any ensemble averaging where you average over a large number of particles, because sometimes that washes out particular details that you're interested in. So these two peaks, they actually correspond to distinct resonant modes in this system. And if you would do a numerical simulation, a finite difference time domain simulation in this case, you would actually be able to identify these different modes. And you can see that there's, for polarization along the short axis, you see the mode in the blue. And for polarization along the long axis, you see this mode in the red. And so these two resonant modes that you see here, they correspond to transverse and longitudinal dipole resonances inside of this particle. And because the particle is rod-like, the degeneracy between these modes is broken. And so if it would be a square, they would be on top of each other. But because it's rectangular, they are not. Now, in fact, you can also recognize the character of these modes based on the spatial maps that you acquire during the spectroscopy acquisition. And so that looks as follows. And so these are the spatial distributions at these wavelengths. Note that this comes from the same data set, because for every point you acquire a full spectrum, so you don't have to do separate measurements to acquire these. And what you can see is that for the wavelength at 590, which corresponds to this transverse dipole resonance, you can see that there are hotspots near the edges on the transverse side. And then for the resonance in the infrared, in fact, you see that the ends of the rods are more efficiently excited. And the reason for that is that the electron is particularly sensitive to the vertical electric field component. Because that is the field component that has the ability to perform work on the electron. And so, in fact, it can decelerate the electron. And so it allows the electron to transfer energy to your plasmonic system. And so if you would plot the vertical electric field component for these two modes, in fact, you see that for the longitudinal mode, the vertical electric field is strong at the ends. Whereas for the transverse mode, it is strong at the side facets. And that you can directly see in this map. And so in fact, you would not even need the numerical simulations to identify the modes. You can purely do it based on the CL pattern. So now that was a single particle. Of course, you can study particles in a wide range of geometries, in sizes, in different materials. And so that is a very popular and good application. Of course, in plasmonics, it's also very interesting to couple particles together in a particular geometry. And here's an example. And so, in fact, this system is composed of rods that are very similar to the previous one that I showed. In this case, we are going to drive the system here where this magenta dot is. And remember that the electron has electric field that sticks out slightly, so you can excite the structure even if you're slightly outside of the structure. Here you see the spectrum. And so the gray curve is what you have for a single rod. And so in fact, that is the rod that I showed in the previous slide. But if you look at this particular system, then you see that there's an extra peak that appears here. And so that is really related to the fact that this rod here couples to the underlying rods. And so the coupling really manifests itself in the spectrum. And you can directly see that. Now, one extra remark I want to make is that in this particular experiment, we also compared our data from the cathodoluminescence with electron energy loss spectroscopy, which is a TEM-based technique where you measure the energy loss that the electron experiences as function of energy. And that is a very complementary technique to cathodoluminescence. I think one of the drawbacks is that your system has to be on a electron transparent substrate, like a membrane, but that was the case in this case. So the interesting thing is that EELS, or energy loss spectroscopy, is sensitive to the total extinction of the particle, so both absorption and scattering. But the in CL, you only measure light that comes out, and so you're only sensitive for scattering. And so if you do the EELS measurement for the same system, you see a similar similar peaks, similar spectrum, but the amplitudes are different. And the reason is that for these peaks here in going towards the blue, the absorption starts to play an increasingly important role, especially for gold. Here you start to approach the interband transition region, and in EELS you see an increased absorption. And by comparing these, you can get a good idea of scattering versus absorption in such systems. So again, you can of course move the electron beam and look at the spectrum change. And so if you excite one of these dimer rods, the spectrum looks very different. And of course, you can also look at the spatial maps, where you can see that the behavior changes quite a bit depending on the wavelength. And the behavior that you see here is a combination of the individual resonant modes that the particles have, but also the coupling. You can no longer really separately describe the system, but it's everything, all the modes here are hybridized, which is also the reason why these are called metamolecules, because in molecules, the orbitals in individual atoms also hybridize to form more complex molecular orbitals. And this is very similar in terms of physics. So in these cases, in some of the previous cases, we looked at localized surface plasmon systems. And now it is interesting to also look at the at propagating plasmons. And so the simplest case you can have for a propagating plasmon is just a flat metallic interface, such as gold. And in order to see cathodoluminescence, you need to corrugate the surface. Otherwise, the plasmons will just stick to the interface, keep propagating, and you won't measure something. But if you make a scattering object, like a grating, for example, and you scan the beam away from the grating, the plasmons have to propagate towards that grating. And while they do so, they experience some damping, ohmic loss in the metal. And that means that by scanning the electron beam away from this grating, you can actually quantify the propagation length of the surface plasmons. And so that is quite a effective and simple way to measure the plasmon propagation length over a large range of wavelengths in one measurement. This was one of the first experiments that was done in the field of plasmonics. And it is very simple, but at the same time, it illustrates that it is a very effective method to characterize such things. And that's why I wanted to show it. Now, you can make it one step more complex by further structuring the surface. This is what is called a ridge waveguide. It's a monolithic piece of gold, which is patterned using focused ion beam milling. But these ridges, they support a guided plasmon mode on top, which can propagate across the ridge. But because it has end facets, those end facets act as mirrors for the plasmon wave. And so in fact, this is a cavity for surface plasmon polaritons as well. It's like an organ pipe for sound. The plasmons travel back and forth and create Fabry-Perot resonances inside of the system. And if you want to measure that, you can scan the electron beam across the length of the of this ridge and see this resonant behavior directly. And so that is shown here. And so here on the vertical axis, you have the electron beam position across the ridge waveguide. This is for a short one, 300 nanometer in size. And on the bottom here, you see a longer one, 800 nanometers in size. And so for the short one, it is still short enough that you only have the two fundamental modes in this system, which are assigned quantum numbers 0 and 1. And for this longer ridge waveguide, you actually see standing waves with more antinodes, increasing number of antinodes. And so the each of these modes can be assigned a quantum number where the integer number indicates how many half plasmon wavelengths fit into this cavity. And so in fact, the m equals one mode corresponds to a mode where half a wavelength fits into the cavity. And this is in fact quite similar to the nanoparticle resonance that I showed in the beginning, the longitudinal dipole resonance. But for longer systems, the behavior becomes more complex. You see more antinodes, and so the mode order increases. And so you can see that more clearly if you take crosscuts to this data. And so you can nicely see the nodes and antinodes in this in these Fabry-Perot modes. And so interestingly, the spacing between the antinodes, especially for higher order modes, corresponds to half plasmon wavelength. And so that means that you can extract the plasmon wavelength from this pattern. And the resonant energy, it can be extracted from the wavelength axis here. And so wherever the pattern is bright, that is where you have one of these resonances. So in this experiment, we did that for many different waveguides with increasing length, ranging from 100 to nanometers to 2 microns. And so you can trace all of these resonances through wavelength space. And as I mentioned, the standing wave pattern, from the standing wave pattern, the plasmon wavelengths can be extracted. And from the resonance position in wavelength, the energy can be extracted. And that means that you can reconstruct a dispersion curve for the plasmon wave, as is shown here. And so each dot here corresponds to a particular data point for one of these ridges, where the plasmon wavelength and the plasmon energy was extracted. And you can see that you can nicely reconstruct the dispersion curve for this system. And the it shows that this plasmon wave is a little bit more confined than just a planar plasmon wave. And that leads to a further, stronger dispersion below the light line, as you can see there. So what else can you learn about this system? And so when you excite it, for example, in the center, the plasmon wave is guided along the ridge because it's below the light line, and so it does not couple to free space. And so, in fact, logically, you can deduce that the plasmons can only couple out at the end facets. So how do you prove that? One of the things you can do is to look at the angular profile. And so these are the angular profiles measured for different mode orders. Here the quantum number is indicated on top. And these are also measured on different lengths, because these mode orders can only be found in particular lengths of these waveguides. And so here, this is one of those angular profiles. The center here corresponds to emission towards the surface normal, and then the subsequent rings correspond to more grazing emission. And so the outer ring corresponds to completely grazing emission. And then here along the circle, you see different azimuthal angles. And so the black part here on top, that is missing because the paraboloid is open on one side. Now, and so what do we see here? And so for the two first modes, m equals zero, m equals one, you can in fact model the emission just with a single dipole. And so that's what is shown here. So this is a vertical dipole, an in-plane dipole. Those match very well to the emission profiles that you measure. And that makes sense because these structures are still very small. They're smaller than the wavelength. And so they really still emit as a point-like dipole. Now, if you increase the size, that no longer is valid. And so you really go from a very local emitter to an emitter where the emission is more delocalized and really comes from the end facets. And so if you want to model that, in fact, you have to model the system as two radiating dipoles, one at each end facet, where the phase between these dipoles is dictated by the plasmon wave that comes in. And so if you do that, in fact, you can get a very good agreement with these measurements. And there's one other thing that you can see here. And so these antenna systems, they if they radiate in a particular direction, that also means that they receive energy efficient in that direction. And so if if there's no emission in a particular direction, that also means that it is very difficult to drive the system with light if you would come in from the opposite direction. And so what you can see is that for 0, 2, and 4, so even order modes, the emission towards the surface normal is dark. And so you can see that here. Whereas for 1, 3, and 5 is bright towards the surface normal. And in fact, it has been shown also in optical experiments that when you irradiate such structures with light from the normal, in fact, you only see the odd order modes and not the even order ones, because the even order ones are symmetry forbidden to excite because they have a symmetric charge distribution. So there's quite a bit of things that you can conclude from such a data set, and it's nicely complementary to the spectroscopy measurements that you can also do in these systems. So this is a similar example that I want to show here. This is a, really an antenna system. It is more directional than the example that I've just shown. And also another important thing is that this is a metal insulator metal geometry, where you have a metal layer and then an insulator layer and another metal layer. And I want to highlight that electron beam excitation is very useful in the context of these types of systems, because the electrons can easily penetrate metal layers, whereas light cannot. And so you can have quite a thick metal layer, 20, 30, 40, 50 nanometers, and still excite this plasmon mode, which is difficult with light because the skin depth for light in such metals is only 10, 15, 20 nanometers or so. And so you lose a lot of energy. And with electrons, you don't have that limitation. Now, so let's look a little bit more closely at this system. So the system is what is known as a patch antenna. This is terminology is borrowed from the radio frequency regime for radio antennas. And so you have a reflective ground plane, then you have a dielectric or a spacer, and then you have the antenna itself, the patch. And in this case, that's a circular patch with diameters ranging from 600 nanometers to almost 3 microns. And so again, you can image the resonant behavior using spectral mapping. And so the modal distribution is quite different depending on wavelength. And the reason why these antennas are of interest is that you can have very strong field confinements in the gap, but you can still have a large lateral size of the antenna, which allows you to make them more directional. And so that would be nice if you could, for example, include emitters here in the center of the patch in this dielectric layer. You would have quite an efficient emission. So you can again probe the directionality using the angle resolved cathodoluminescence technique. And so if you excite one of those systems in the center, you can see quite a directional donut-like beam, which really originates from the edge also. So similar to the ridge, the plasmons stay confined to the patch until they reach the end, and then they scatter out yield efficient directionality. So you can do this for many different patch diameters and wavelengths. And as you make the patches larger, they become more directional, as you can see. And so this is a general rule for antennas, is that you can make them more directional as they increase in size. And you can also measure the wavelength dependence. One of the great things about electron beam excitation is that you can put your beam at any position that you like. And in the context of antennas, I really like to think of the electron beam as a model emitter. It's a model system for a single emitter. And so in the end, a lot of these antenna systems, they are meant to be coupled to a molecule or a quantum dot or a diamond or any emitter type. And what the electron does is it behaves very similarly to such point sources. But the benefit is that the electron beam, it still has broadband character, so you can measure for a lot of different wavelengths, unlike a molecule, which normally has a single emission wavelength. It also cannot be destroyed or bleached. The electron beam is constant. It will always be there. And you can easily position it. And so if you want to position a molecule in situ, then you need a scanning probe technique or something complicated to operate. And with cathodoluminescence, you're not limited by that. And so it is a great way to model the performance of your antenna systems. And here's an example of that. And so you move the electron beam from the center to the edge of your antenna, and you see what happens to the directionality and the performance of your system. You can see that it becomes asymmetric, that is radiated to the, that is related to the fact that you change the phase of the emission at the edges of the patch. And if you compare that to model, you can see that that matches well. But by measuring it, you can really quantify how the such a system behaves for a given driving or excitation position. So as a final example, I wanted to also briefly discuss a bullseye antenna. A bullseye antenna is a little bit and one step more complex than the previous example. It's more towards a metasurface where you have a structured surface that there's a particular thing with the plasmons. And in this particular case, the when you drive such a system with electrons, you excite the surface plasmons and they propagate towards the fraction grating. So the light couples out in a particular way dictated by the interaction of the surface plasmons with the grating. We have studied this with the polarization resolved technique. I won't go into detail about how we actually do that. That will be a separate topic for a different webinar, I think. But in any case, what you can do is you can measure the polarization distribution of this light as function of angle. And that is shown here. And so these are the field amplitudes, the zenithal and azimuthal field components, or P and S components, if you like. And what you can see is that for this excitation geometry, where you excite this circular bullseye from the center, you predominantly get P-polarized light, which is also expected based on the polarization of the plasmons. But this is something that you can nicely resolve using the polarization resolved technique. Now, we have done some variations on this, where we broke the symmetry in the system by moving the electron away from the center, or by moving to a chiral bullseye, for example, spiral. And then this behavior is completely different. And so you can have both zenithal and azimuthal components. And especially for the chiral structures, you can also have circular components present in your system. So this is one way to look at things. And so another thing we have done is to look at the behavior of elliptical bullseyes, and then with the energy momentum mapping. As mentioned, there is another webinar on how that works technically, but what I do want to show is that you can beautifully map the directionality, which is here in k-space or angular space, versus energy or wavelength. This here shows that the structure is very directional, but the directionality changes as function of wavelength because of the periodicity of these grooves. This you can do along many different directions of these elliptical bullseyes. This is another way of measuring on these systems. To conclude, cathodoluminescence is a very powerful technique for studying the optical properties of plasmonic systems. There's a lot of other things that you can do with it. I have here some other examples of exciting things that are happening or that people are working on. One example is electron-driven light sources. This is pioneered by Nahid Talebi. Her idea is that you can generate light with such a meta lens structure, which is driven by plasmons. That creates a particular light wave that can then itself interact again with the electron or with another material and allow for very unique and novel pump probe geometry. That would be a very interesting thing. Another thing that is currently being worked on is to also extract the global phase of the cathodoluminescence emission. You can already determine the handedness of the polarization itself, so spin, orbital, angular momentum, so whether something is circularly polarized, left-handed, right-handed, etc. But if you, for example, have orbital angular momentum, that's also something interesting that you would like to measure. And Nick Schilder at AMOV has already done quite some work in this direction. And so there's more to come in that field as well. And finally, as I mentioned, a lot of plasmonic systems are meant to interact or enhance emission from single emitters. And so you can use the electron beam to emulate a single emitter and to test how well your structure would work. But you can also do actual experiments on systems where the emitter is already included, because the electron beam provides such a precise excitation, way of exciting your system. And something in that direction has already been done at King's College in London, where they used a particle chain to couple plasmons to a nanodiamond. And also in that range of systems, I think there's a lot of interesting things to study. So with that, I would like to thank you for your attention, and let's see if there are any more questions. And so the one of the questions is whether it is possible to get a PowerPoint copy, and whether the webinar will be available after this. And so we always publish the recording of the webinar on our website and also on YouTube afterwards. And for the PowerPoint, please send me a personal message. My email address is in the beginning of the presentation, I think. It's coenen@delmic.com. And so I don't think there's any proprietary things in this presentation, so I can probably share it. It will be on YouTube anyway. So yeah, that's possible. With that, I would like to end. And so thank you.
Thank you for joining us. As Toon mentioned already a couple of times during the webinar, we have a whole collection of different webinars dedicated to different techniques and the way that they are applied in different fields. So please feel free to check that out on our website, delmic.com. And if you have still any questions for us, please feel free to contact Toon directly or us at info@delmic.com. With that, we would like to thank you for joining us today and wish you a good end of the day.